Well, that was easy. The next method is a little more complicated. cellForRowAtIndexPath is the method that the table view uses to get cell objects one at a time. There's a challenge in the implementation of this method. It isn't so difficult, but sometimes it trips people up. This challenge comes from an optimization that tables need. Consider how fast we like to be able to scroll through tables. iPhone users want to be able to swipe along a list in a split second. It's an interesting technical challenge. Each row is a fairly complex view object. If we have to swipe through a few hundred rows, that's a lot of objects to allocate. Too many objects, as it turns out. If every cell had to be allocated as it appears on the screen, the scrolling would get choppy. So Apple's worked out a caching scheme to reuse these cell objects over and over. Kind of like stairs on an escalator, when cell objects scroll off the screen, they get reused on the other side. Anything that is shared across cells gets reused. Cell border, image placement, recurring control elements, recurring labels, the structure of the cell's data. This means these shared elements don't need to be respecified when a cell comes onto the screen. Only the data needs to be respecified. At any given time, there will be a few table view cell objects that are off the screen in a queue, waiting to come back on screen with new data. Because of this, we never need to construct cells ourselves. The queue is kept inside the table view, so whenever we need a cell, we dequeue one from the table view, populate it with data, and we're good to go. Some tables combine more than one type of cell. To accommodate that, cells are tagged with string reuse identifiers to keep them separate. In those cases, the tables keep separate queues for each type of cell. Our favorite things table only needs one kind of cell, but we'll still need to give the cells a reuse identifier. All right, let's figure out what the code should look like.